Shall I start, Ganesh?
Wait a minute. So
Okay, sure, sure.
Because so last session got extended by some
okay.
5 minutes.
Okay.
So people will be joining.
Sure.
करो सर।
यस हाँ कहीं ना
हाँ, डिस्टन्स मॅट्रिक्स वरती जास्त मटेरियल नाही दिसत म्हणजे असं वाटतं, म्हणजे डिस्टन्स मॅट्रिक्स फक्त ट्रीज रिलेटेड आहे कंटेंट।
बोलूया आपण नंतर।
हो ना
प्रियव्रत, प्रियव्रत आय थिंक वी कॅन स्टार्ट नाव।
श्योर, या आय एम रेडी।
हा ओके।
Okay, so I'll start. Right. So yeah, so today I'm going to focus on a related problem, but sort of about combinatorial statistic that comes from arrangements, and sort of this happens to be joint work with Krishna Menon, who's a graduate student at CMI, and Anurag Singh, who was a postdoc till at CMI till a couple of weeks ago. He just recently joined IIT Delhi. Okay, so I think before I start, I'm supposed to talk about braid arrangements, especially why is the name braid, right? So this is a very quick overview of this reason. We all know the symmetric group, which is the group of all bijections from a finite set. Self-bijections of a finite set. So there is a presentation of the symmetric group where all generators are of order 2, and these are precisely the adjacent transpositions. So I going to I plus 1, that's a transpose. So it's generated by exactly n minus 1 of these adjacent transpositions. And the relations are that each of these adjacent transposition is an involution, so SI square is equal to 1. Whenever I and J are not adjacent, the corresponding generators SI times SJ, they commute. That means SI SJ square is equal to 1. And for adjacent transpositions, SI times SI plus 1, adjacent indices I and I plus 1. So SI and SI plus 1, the relation is that its cube is identity. So that's a presentation for the symmetric group. Now, if I were to form a new group where I take generators in bijection with the transpositions, but I remove the involution relations, and the remaining two relations I make a sort of key. Then I get a new group, right? It's called the braid group on n strands. So the generators, I'll just call them sigma 1, sigma 2, up to sigma n minus 1. So these are abstract generators. So this is just a presentation. And the only relations are that sigma I times sigma I plus 1 times sigma I is equal to sigma I plus 1 times sigma I plus 1 whenever I mean for I and I plus 1. So whenever j is not equal to I plus 1, we have sigma I times sigma j is equal to sigma j times sigma I, which means that they commute, right? So now the first relation here, I plus 1 I, so this is what is called as a braid relation, because you can think of this as braiding of say hair or two locks of hair or whatever, or say braiding of two ropes. So you can actually have a longer braid relation. That's what the RT groups, that's where they come. Anyway, so let me show you a picture here. So one, so a trivial braid, right? So trivial braid basically means that it's a sort of a rope or a hair which is just straight. Okay. Now what it means to be sigma I. So sigma I basically means that the ith braid, sort of ith rope, comes over the I plus first. And sigma inverse is I plus first over I. Okay, so this is not, so these are not intersections. So you can think of it as either going over or going under. And then sigma I times sigma j is equal to sigma j times sigma I is sort of depicted here, because then you have the sigma I here. So I goes over I plus 1, and here you have j goes over j plus 1. And this is, so I should tell you what the group operation is in terms of these braids. So if you want to compose or whatever, if you want to multiply, what you do is, so you basically just concatenate. So if I want to do sigma I times sigma I inverse, what I would do is I will start from here, end up here, right? So, and then I will take the sigma inverse and I will paste it down here. Okay. So this is what this means. So these are, you can think of these as braids on two strands of whatever hair or rope. Then you have braids on three strands here. So this is a way of depicting the elements of the braid group. Or you can just play with these abstract symbols, or you can sort of do your mathematics using this geometric braids or whatever geometric symbols, right? So there is a reason for this. Before that, I should tell you that you can map the sigma I, a generator of the braid group, to the corresponding generator of the symmetric group, and that mapping induces a epimorphism at the level of groups, and the kernel of this epimorphism is called as a pure braid group on n strings. So what happens here is that the in braids, the starting point of a strand, we may permute those, but in pure braids that doesn't happen. The starting point and the ending point are same. The rope may wiggle in between the travel. Okay. And the reason, I mean, the relationship with the braid arrangement is that there is this object called as a configuration space of n ordered points in the plane, which is denoted as u conf c for unordered, I messed up the symbol. So this should have been conf and this should have been u conf. Sorry. But yeah, sorry for this. But anyway, so whatever this u conf NC is, so we look at all tuples of complex numbers, n tuples of complex numbers, such that no two of them are equal. So we are basically looking at the set of all possible n element subsets in C. Okay? and we want distinct elements, right? And so here the ordering is intact. So I know which is the first element, I know which is the second element, and no two elements or no two points are same. Now I can have an action of the symmetric group on this particular set, and the action is simple. The action is basically just permuting the coordinates. Now this action has no fixed points, by which I mean that if you look at if you take any permutation and apply it, right? So whatever is the result, say for example, if I have only two points, right? So then the symmetric group on two letters S2 is just the group of order two. Then if I have two points Z1 and Z2, if the identity acts, then I have to do nothing. And if the non-identity element acts, then I have to send Z1 to Z2, Z1. Right. So this action has no fixed points. So any non-identity element will change the tuple to a different tuple. And what happens is that the ordering changes. So in an unordered configuration space, I don't really care about the ordering of the element. So for example, if I have a tuple 1, 2, 3, right? So in the ordered configuration, the tuple 1, 2, 3 is different from 3, 2, 1. But in the unordered configuration, 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, 1, 3, 2, 1, all these, all the points with whose coordinates are a permutation of 1, 2, 3 will represent just a single point. Okay, so that's the configuration space of unordered points. And a theorem of, okay, so this is a connected topological space, and one can define one can compute the fundamental group of these spaces. So the fundamental group of the configuration space of ordered points is the pure braid group on n strands, and the fundamental group of configuration space of n unordered points is the braid group on n strands. So that's a theorem of Fedel and Neumer from the 60s. This is sort of how the picture looks like. Suppose I have three points, right? So they are, suppose this is part of the plane. So what it means is that I want to look at how these points move in the plane without colliding. So now, so let's say that they start moving at time t equal to zero. And what happens at say time some t equal to one or whatever. So they are say moving. So at t equal to zero, they were here. And throughout this time, throughout the this time interval, the third point did not move. So think of this each level in this cylinder as a representative of the situation at that particular time. So this point had moved slightly. So if you look at the top view, you would see that these points are sort of moving around each other in the plane, but if you sort of see them vertically as the time passes, you will see this sort of movement that because there is no collision, you'll see them braid around, so that the paths that this trace out form these paths form these braids, and so these are you can take them as generators of the fundamental group. So what you see here, so this is in fact a pure braid, because at the beginning this was the location, and at the end this is the same location, right? Or I could have had that this first point end up in the second position and the second point end up in the first position. This was a possibility. So these points move, and then at whatever, say time t equal to 1 or 10 or whatever, they come back to the specified position. It could be their original position, or it could be a slightly different, I mean, the position of some other point. So that's allowed. These are the pictures. So this is a picture of a pure braid, but you could have non-pure braids. And the reason this is called the braid arrangement, because the configuration space of ordered endpoints in C is basically the complement in Cn of the following set, Zi minus Zj equal to zero. and this set is a union of hyperplanes. So if I just look at the equations are these diagonal hyperplanes, and that is the reason why this union of hyperplanes given by the equations that I'm in the set JQ, or x I minus x equal to 0 if you're in the real case, this is called as the braid arrangement. And in the complex case, the complement is a connected topological space. On the other hand, in the real case, it's disconnected, and there are exactly n factorial many connected components. Is that fine? I mean, that's there are a lot of things that I didn't explain, but that's one of the reasons. That's the reason why this is called braid arrangement. Okay, so then I can move on to today's topic. So I'll just like to quickly remind. So we are looking at hyperplane arrangements. So it's a finite set of, say, affine hyperplanes in Rn. And we are interested in the complement of the union of these hyperplanes. And since we are in the real world, once you remove hyperplanes, which are of codimension one, the vector space or the Euclidean space breaks up into convex subsets. And each of this convex subset is called as a region, and we are interested in counting the number of regions. Okay, so we have this intersection poset, which is the set of all, or the partially ordered set of non-empty intersections of hyperplanes, and we order them by reverse inclusion. We also define this Mobius function to capture the inclusion-exclusion principle, and it's recursively defined. And the characteristic polynomial of the arrangement is the generating function for the Mobius values. So here are the examples. So this is the intersection poset. This is the characteristic polynomial. And yeah, so the important problem. So when you have an arrangement, when we have a central arrangement, which means that the intersection, the grand intersection, is non-empty, and it is in fact the contains the origin, which means that each of my hyperplane is a subspace, is a codimension one subspace and not its translate. So in that case, this intersection poset is in fact a geometric lattice and a matroid. And in this case, it's a semi-lattice, but every interval is a geometric lattice. So I sort of happened to join the earlier talk also, and there was some mention of zonotope. So I just like to make one comment, which I did not intend to make. So if there is a one-to-one correspondence between isomorphism classes of n-dimensional zonotopes and isomorphism classes of rank n arrangements. In fact, the zonotope here is a hexagon. And yeah, so in fact, the polar dual of any hyperplane arrangement is a zonotope. And once given a geometrically defined zonotope, you can construct a hyperplane arrangement which is dual to this. And in case of affine hyperplane arrangements, what you get is a zonotopal tiling of a disk, right? Yeah, anyway, but it's not the point of today's talk. Okay, so a property of geometric lattices is that the Mobius values alternate in signs. As you change the grade, the signs change. So at the base, you have positive sign, then you have negative, then positive, and so on. So what happens is that the your characteristic polynomial, the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial have alternating signs. So t, the coefficient, it's a monic polynomial. So coefficient of t raised to n is actually plus one, then coefficient of t raised to n minus one is negative, and so on. Okay, so then I can sort of rewrite the characteristic polynomial like this. So because I want to deal with coefficients without worrying about their signs, and the amazing theorem of Zaslavsky is that the number of regions you can compute by evaluating the characteristic polynomial at minus one and then ignoring the sign, which is equivalently, you just add up the coefficients, ignoring the signs. Okay. Again, here, so I sort of showed you yesterday. Right. Yeah, so by Zaslavsky's theorem, we have that the number of regions is basically just the sum of coefficients of the characteristic polynomial barring the sign. So now the question is, which people have thought about, is when the regions of an arrangement are in bijection with a combinatorial defined set, is there a statistic on the set that induces this breakup? Okay. So maybe I should tell you first about what is meant by a statistic. So a definition of combinatorial statistic, or just statistic, is that given a collection of combinatorially defined objects, so for n equal to 1, you have some set, then n equal to 2, n equal to 3. For example, O1 could be just singleton 1. O2 is 1, 2, the set 1, 2. O3 is set 1, 2, 3. Or O n is the symmetric group on n symbols. So anyway, so something which, a collection of sets which is parameterized by natural numbers. Now, a statistic is a function defined on the union of all these O n's, and it is an integer value, so positive, a non-negative integer valued function. Any function is called a statistic. And a distribution of this statistic is basically, so you pick a value in the codomain or in the image, you pick a natural number and see how many n elements from On achieve I, or map to I. So that is called as a distribution of the statistic. And again, in algebraic combinatorics, analytic combinatorics, there's a lot of literature studying various kinds of statistic. In fact, now there is a sort of an online encyclopedia of combinatorially defined statistics. So it's just like your OEIs, online encyclopedia of integer sequences, where you could just type in some numbers and then it shows if these numbers are of, they count something, or what do these numbers mean. So similarly, we have a encyclopedia of combinatorially defined statistics. Okay, so I'll give you examples of very commonly occurring statistics, especially on the permutation group. So first is called as a descent statistic. So given a permutation, you count at how many places there is a drop. So for example, if my permutation is say 1, 3, 2, right? So it takes 1 to 1, 2 to 3, and 3 to 2, then after 1, there is an increase 3, but after 3, there is a drop 2. So in this permutation, there is one drop. So there's one descent. So given a permutation, you count how many descents or how many drops there are, right? So that's a statistic. Similarly, you can count the number of ascents or you can count number of excedences, or we all know in the first course on group theory, we learned that any permutation can be decomposed into cycles, right? So the number of cycles that you need to represent a permutation, so that number of cycles is also a statistic, or the number of inversions in a permutation is also a statistic, and there are many more. Or the simplest statistic I can think of is that given an n element set, the number of subsets, given the power set of 1 to up to n, we count the number of subsets of size k. So that's also a statistic, and its distribution is exactly the binomial coefficients. Right. So let me give you sort of this chamber or region induced statistic, right? So the statistic which is induced by the coefficients of the threshold characteristic polynomial, right? So again, here is a braid arrangement. And we saw that the regions correspond to permutations, and the number of regions is exactly equal to n factorial. And the characteristic polynomial of this arrangement is t into t minus 1 into t minus 2 dot up to t minus n minus 1. So this is precisely the falling factorial, right? And the coefficients. So if I write this as a polynomial in T, this is the coefficients are this sort of square bracket ni. So these are not the binomial coefficients, but these are what also known as the unsigned Stirling numbers of the first kind, and this n bracket I counts the number of permutations in SN with exactly I disjoint cycles. So in the cycle decomposition, you have I cycles. And so the coefficients of this characteristic polynomial of the braid arrangement form the distribution of the cycle statistic, which is sort of completely, it's amazing because this is something geometric, there is no cycles involved, but suddenly you see that the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial are the, so those numbers are the distribution of the cycle statistic. So it's an amazing thing, right? Okay, so here is how it looks like. So this is the region corresponding to the identity permutation, 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 2. I think this 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 2, 3 goes to 3. And the remaining, so we've got three cycles, each of length 1. And then here is a just one cycle, two cycles, one cycle, two cycles, two cycles. Okay. So this is what you see here. So there is exactly 1 3 cycle. There are three, two cycles, 1 2 3, and there are 2 1 cycles, 1 3 2 and 1 2 3. Okay, right. So this is sort of the question that people have thought about, that you take an interesting arrangement, look at the number of regions, try to find out a combinatorially defined set which it counts, find a bijection, and see what if there is a statistic induced by the threshold the characteristic polynomial. Right. So now let me turn your attention to something called as threshold graphs, which are I think also known as perfect graphs. Right. So what is a threshold graph? So I'm going to define it. I think there are lots of definitions, equivalent definitions of threshold graphs. I'm going to talk about three definitions today. So the first definition is that the empty graph is the unique threshold graph on no vertex. An n vertex graph G is a threshold graph. It is obtained by taking a threshold graph G prime on n minus 1 vertex and adding a new vertex, which is either a dominant vertex, which means that when you add that vertex, you draw edges from all the previous vertices to that particular, the new vertex that you've added. Or it's a recessive vertex, which means that when you just add the vertex and you don't add any more any edges. Okay. And a labeled threshold graph is basically you take a threshold graph and label the vertices distinctly using 1 to up to n. Okay, so I'm going to give you an example of a threshold graph. So I have empty graph, which is a threshold graph on zero vertices. Now I'm going to take one vertex. It doesn't matter whether it's dominant or recessive because earlier I did not have any vertices at all. Right. So then I've got added the second vertex and it's a recessive vertex. I'm not going to add any edge. Then I'm going to add a third vertex and I want it to be dominant vertex. So I have to add an edge. I have to connect it to the first leaf, the vertex that I added first, and also connect to the vertex that I added at the second stage. Then the fourth vertex is also dominant, but the fifth vertex is recessive. It's isolated from the previous one, and then I label them. Okay. Now, there's a lot of literature on threshold graphs and labeled threshold graph. In fact, the book titled Threshold Graphs and Applications is quite famous. Anyway, so actually trying to compute the all possible labeled threshold graphs was first attempted by Bisinger and Peled in a paper from 1987, and they came up with this expression, which is 2 raised to k times n minus k times a of n minus 1 times k minus 1, whatever it is. So these a and k are the Eulerian numbers. I'll tell you a bit about them later. But actually, the count was not so straightforward. Was sort of difficult to understand and expressed mainly in terms of the exponential generating function that you see at the bottom. But last year, Sam Spiro wrote a really nice short paper giving an explicit count, using a really clever argument. Right, so what are the Eulerian numbers? So Eulerian numbers are basically A and K. So it's again like a binomial coefficient because they are palindromic. So it's a number of permutations in Sn which have descent exactly at k stage, k places. So that's a distribution of the descent statistic. That's an, again, Eulerian numbers is an amazing topic in itself. They're related to a lot of things, not just in combinatorics, but also in complex analysis, commutative algebra, and many, many other branches. Right. So that's Eulerian number. So that's what this formula was. Again, it sort of looks a bit complicated. Anyway, so this is what this formula is. At the thing is, we want to understand this. Let me go. Now, there is an alternate definition of threshold graph, which is as follows. Right. So a threshold graph G on the vertex, a graph G on the vertex set 1 top 2n is called a threshold graph if there exist non-negative real numbers xi, one for each I, such that whenever I and j are not equal, xi times xj is positive or greater than some weight if and only if ij is an edge. Okay. So as soon as I see xi plus xj, that's if xi and xj were indeterminate, that gives me equation of a hyperplane, and xi plus xj greater than zero, or in fact in the original definition there's some non-negative real number w which is called as the weight or the threshold actually. And xi and xj are called vertex weights. So whenever there is an edge, the vertices of that edge, so the vertex weights of any edge, they should add up to at least the threshold. That's how they get the name threshold graph. Right. So is there a relationship between threshold graphs and half spaces defined by xi plus xj strictly greater than zero? And if there is some relationship, can this be exploited to count the number of labeled threshold graphs? So I'm going to quickly answer both these questions. So I'm going to define something called as a threshold arrangement. And it's xi plus xj equal to zero. That's it. So yesterday we spent time looking at xi minus xj equal to zero. So today we'll spend time looking at equations xi plus xj equal to zero. It's very different from xi minus xj. And the reason it's called threshold arrangement is that the regions of this arrangement are in bijection with labeled threshold graphs on n vertices, which is sort of amazing. Because there's an easy, it's not difficult to prove this. So given a region R, so basically, if I have a region R, it means it's uniquely determined by inequalities of the form xi plus xj with either strictly greater than zero or strictly less than zero. So what I would do is I'll construct a graph GR corresponding to a region such that there IJ will be an edge if and only if XI plus XJ is positive in that region. Okay. Otherwise, if it's negative, then IJ is not an edge. Okay. And then sort of need to do some work, but it's essentially not complicated to show that first of all, R is uniquely determined by these inequalities, which is kind of obvious. Then one has to show that this graph that we create has at least one vertex which is either dominating or an isolated vertex. Once you find that vertex, remove it and then sort of repeat the argument and you get this step-by-step definition of threshold graph that you're able to recover. So whenever you have xi plus xj strictly positive, you draw an edge between I and J, and the graph that you get is a labeled threshold graph. And similarly, a graph like this gives you a region of this arrangement. So that is the name So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and compute the characteristic polynomial. I can use the finite field method, which says that the characteristic polynomial evaluated at some arbitrarily large odd number q is some n tuples in Zn q such that sum of any two distinct ai and aj is non-zero. That's it. So there's some sort of combinatorics that you work out and you see that you get an expression like this. So here S and K is the number of ways to partition n objects into k non-empty subsets. So these are called the Stirling numbers of the second kind. And again, there are various ways to get a closed form expression for S and K. So I'm not really interested today in writing down the expression, but I could just say that there's a recursion. So S and K is exactly K times S n minus 1, comma K plus S of n minus 1, comma K minus 1. So it's K times number of ways to partition n minus 1 objects into K non-empty subsets plus number of ways to partition n minus 1 objects in K minus 1 non-empty subsets. So that's sort of the recurrence S and K have. There is a very nice relationship between Stirling numbers of the first kind and the second kind. So we saw that Stirling numbers of the first kind are the coefficients of the falling factorial polynomial. Now, if you express x raised to k as a polynomial in falling factorials, this is what pops out as coefficients. Anyway, again, that's an interesting story for some other day. And the number of regions of this arrangement comes out to be sort of this thing, which is an minus n into an minus 1. So an is the ordered Bell number. It basically counts the number of different ways to partition an n element set. And it is the sum of all SN, I mean, sum of SNKs for fixed n and all k, all values of k, right? So now this is another compact expression for the number of labeled threshold graphs, okay? Okay, so now I want to go back to the question that I posed earlier, which was actually first written down by Richard Stanley in his notes on hyperplane arrangement. So Stanley has this sort of habit. So he's an extensive collection of problems. Even if you look at his book on enumerative combinatorics, volume one or volume two, for every chapter, he has like hundreds of problems, not hundreds, but a lot of problems. And each problem is assigned sort of this difficulty level. So one means very easy, two means something, three means you have to do something like this, four means really difficult, it's solved in a problem. And five basically means unsolved problems. And five minus basically means that Stanley thinks they are easy for him. If he decides to solve them, he can solve them. And five plus are the problems which Stanley thinks that there is no, at least he doesn't know any solution. So, like, he has no idea how to solve those problems. So five minus problem was, five minus level problem is this. So Tn is the threshold arrangement. So that was done earlier. So I didn't have that. So this is a clipping from his notes. And he said, okay, so this is the three-dimensional threshold arrangement, and this is the characteristic polynomial. This is the characteristic polynomial for four-dimensional threshold arrangement, and so on. So now we know that by Zaslavsky's theorem, a0 plus a1 whatever is the number of total number of labeled threshold graphs, right? So give a combinatorial interpretation of the numbers ai as the number of threshold graphs with a certain property. So just like we saw in the Braid case, we had n factorial regions, right? And the coefficients of the, and they were in bijection with permutations, and coefficients of the characteristic polynomial told us that I coefficient means the number of permutations with I cycles. In the cycle decomposition, there are I cycles. So is there a interpretation of this in the context of threshold rate. So this is from, I think, 2004. Yeah, so we thought, okay, let's solve this. So this is how the polynomial looks like for n equal to 2, 3, 4, 6, 10. And these are the number of regions. So first thing sort of we did was we ran this number in OES, search in OES. Of course, it came out to be labeled threshold graphs. And then we tried looking for these coefficients. Like, has anyone in the world sort of thought about these coefficients, what they can do, what these numbers mean? We tried both this online encyclopedia and also this encyclopedia of integer sequences as well as combinatorial statistics. Nowhere we could find mention of these numbers, so it was completely different. So, okay. So here is the answer, like one answer could give. So, okay, so let me define some terms. In a construction of a labeled threshold graph, an anchor is a vertex whose label is smaller than all the vertex labels added after it. So we'll call this an anchor. An anchor is odd if it is of different type from the previous anchor. A different type in the sense, suppose the previous anchor is a dominant vertex and the next anchor is a recessive vertex, then the next anchor is odd. And the first anchor, which is always one, is odd if it is dominant. So that's our definition. I'll show you in the pictures again. And what we prove is that the absolute value of the coefficients of Tj in the characteristic polynomial chi Tn is the number of labeled threshold graphs on n vertices with exactly j odd anchors. Okay, it's probably complicated. Okay, so let me show you. So let's look at threshold graphs on two vertices. There are exactly two threshold graphs. One is where both vertices are isolated, and and the second is where there's an edge. Okay, so that threshold graphs on two vertices. So here I can declare that one is dominant and two is isolated, and both are anchors and both are odd because their types are different. So there are two odd anchors, and here one is dominant, two is also dominant. So this is an anchor, but they are of the same type. So two is not an odd anchor, it's just an anchor. So there is exactly one odd anchor. So two and one. And so, yeah, so, sorry, what was it? Yeah, exactly. So I have coefficient t square minus t, right? Okay, so, yeah, so then there is one, yeah, so there is one graph with two odd anchors and one graph with one odd anchor. Now, these are all threshold graphs on three vertices. And there is exactly one graph with three odd anchors. There are three graphs with two odd anchors. There are three graphs with exactly one odd anchor. And there is one graph with no odd anchor. So t cube, because so coefficient of t cube is one because there is exactly one graph with three odd anchors, three graphs with two odd anchors, three graph with one odd anchor, and one graph with zero odd anchors. So that's what we do, right? Yeah, again, I mean, if you have questions or something is not clear, please do not hesitate to interrupt. Right. So how does one come up with something like this, right? So let me, so the next remaining part, I'll try to address this. Yeah, I really don't want to make it boring or too technical. So I'll, even though I've got all arguments written up, not sure if this is, like the stock is becoming really technical. So let me try and give you an overview or sort of the main tricks that one can use. Right. So we figured out that a convenient, I mean, not we figured out, but we realized that the convenient way of representing threshold graphs is really not drawing their pictures, but rather finding a convenient way of representing them. And the convenient way is as follows. So we have labels for the vertices, and vertex is either dominant or recessive, right? So whenever I have a label of those vertices, right? So I add vertices, labeled vertices in some order. So I'll write them down. So pi 1 is my label of the first vertex. Pi 2 is the label of the second vertex that I have, and so on. And on top, I will write plus if the vertex is dominant. I'll write minus if the vertex is negative. So below, I have some permutation of 1 to up to n. And on every number, I have either plus or minus, some sign associated with it. So I'll call this thing a signed permutation. And I will say that a signed permutation tells me how to construct that graph. Okay, so now I have a signed permutation, 2 minus 3 minus 1 plus 6 minus 4 plus 5 plus, which means that 2, 3, 6 are recessive vertices and 1, 4, 5 are dominant. And the order in which one has to draw them is 2, 3, 1, 6, 4, 5. So it's a threshold graph, labeled threshold graph with 6 vertices. So I add 2. It's an isolated vertex. But anyway, first vertex being isolated dominant does not really make any sense. So fine. Now 3 is isolated, so I don't draw an edge between 3 and 2. 1 is dominant, so I connect to both 2 and 3 to 1. 6 is isolated. 4 is dominant. 5 is dominant. Right. So 5 edges from 5 to all the previous 5 vertices. So got 5 edges. Okay. So that's a But you see here, I could have had, instead of 2 minus 3 minus, I could have 2 plus 3 minus, 1 plus 6 minus, 5 plus 4 plus. It'll give me the exact same isomorphic graph. Absolute no change, because it doesn't really matter whether 2 is dominant or recessive, right? Because it's being added the first, right? So it doesn't really matter what is the sign of the first number. And consecutive numbers with the same sign can be swapped. And the isomorphism class of the graph doesn't really change. So what it tells me is that they are not equinumerous with signed permutations, because signed permutations are easy to count. But so they are not equinumerous with signed permutations. They're actually less than signed permutations. And two signed permutations may give same graph. And this is exactly the thing. If the signs of the first number, it doesn't really matter. And consecutive numbers with the same sign can be swapped. So this motivates a definition, which is that a threshold pair of size n in standard form is a signed permutation such that the first two signs are same. And if ith sign and I plus first sign is same, then the ith number is smaller than the I plus first number, right? So what we know is that the first two signs don't matter. I mean, the first sign doesn't matter. So what we'll do is we'll just assign it the sign of the second number. And consecutive numbers with the same sign can be swapped. So if you get a block of consecutive numbers with same sign, just order that block in ascending order. That's what I'm saying. And you could show that there's again still a bijection between such standard form pairs or whatever, standard form sign permutations and threshold graphs. Right? Now the next is expression for the characteristic polynomial, which I already told you involves this complicated looking expression, which in terms of the Stirling numbers of the second kind, and some polynomial whose roots are odd numbers, starting from 1. So t minus 1 into t minus 3 into t minus 4 up to t minus 2k minus 1. Okay. So then some manipulation, if you do, you just want to understand what is the coefficient of t in this thing, it comes out to be this expression, where again, this thing involving Stirling numbers of the second kind, and akj is the coefficient of t plus 1 into t plus 3 into t plus 2k minus 1. So it doesn't really matter if I replace minus by plus, the coefficients don't change. Right? So these are actually, then we figured out that these things are known. So if you look at the coefficients of this, and there are various combinatorial objects that these coefficients count, and these are called type B Stirling numbers of the first kind. Because we had type A Stirling numbers are basically coefficients of t into t minus 1 or whatever, t into t plus 1 into t plus 2 into t plus 3 into t plus 4 and so on. So here we are only looking at odd numbers. So these are type B Stirling numbers. So we basically have to figure out what does this count in terms of, in the context of threshold graphs. So is there some meaning? So do we see partitions in threshold graphs? Do we see these coefficients occurring in threshold graphs? And that's how we got the meaning of this, right? So we define in a construction of threshold graph or a signed permutation, an anchor is a vertex whose label is smaller than all vertices after. So let's say this is my construct, this is my threshold graph, 6 plus, 2 minus, 3 plus. So this is not in standard form, which is okay. After 1, there is an increase. So 1 is an anchor. So 4, it ends at 4. So it's also an anchor. So again, 1 is an anchor because after 1, the next immediate entry is bigger than 1. So then 5, 2 is an anchor because after 2, the next immediate entry is 4, which is bigger than 2. And 4 is an anchor by definition. And odd anchor,
after 2, there is a 3, right?
So. Yes. I forgot to mark this. So 2 is also an anchor. Yeah, thanks. I was probably sleeping. Yeah. A vertex whose label is smaller than. Smaller than all vertices added after it. So 2 is smaller than 3. That is correct, but it is bigger than
1.
All vertices. Yeah, you're right. So 1 obviously is always the first anchor. And we call an anchor odd if the signs are different. So you have anchors and you look at the signs. If the consecutive anchors have different sign, then you call that an odd anchor. So for example, and for convenience, we declare that 1 is always an anchor, and if it gets plus sign, we'll call it odd. Otherwise, we would not call it odd. But that's changeable. You can also call it odd if it's minus. So you sort of make some bookkeeping change, but that's fine. So here, we saw that 1 and 4 are odd, but only 4 is an odd anchor because it has different sign than the previous anchor, which was also 1 minus and 4 plus. So the signs are different. So 4 is an odd anchor. So 1 plus is an odd anchor because we declared so. But 2 is not an odd anchor because the previous anchor had the same sign. Same thing for 4 is not an odd anchor because the previous anchor also had the same sign. Then what we do is, we form blocks. So these numbers with consecutive numbers with same sign, we'll sort of separate them into blocks. Okay. So the set of numbers forming a maximal string with the same sign in a threshold pair in standard, we'll call this a block. And the blocks of a labeled threshold graph are those of the corresponding threshold pair in standard form. So some terminology. Right. So if 1 is in the first block, it is added first as a dominant vertex. So this is just some convention that we adopt for constructing threshold graph. So it will not matter, but we'll just choose that as our representative. Yeah. So here is an example where the convention is not followed. Here is an example where it is followed. Yeah. So the number of odd anchors in threshold graph, it does not depend on construction. An absolute value of the coefficient is the number of graphs on n vertices with j odd anchors. So this is the answer to the question of Stanley, right? So anyway, so going back after defining terminologies, if you sort of forgotten what was the scary looking polynomial, so this is it. So the coefficient of t raised to j in the polynomial is this strange looking expression that involves these Stirling numbers and coefficients of this polynomial. So just for the sake of simplifying writing, I'm going to set n n j as this part here, s n k into a k j. Okay, this is my n n j. So then this thing becomes n n j minus small n times capital N of n minus one j. This is, I mean, just to save writing, doesn't really mean anything, at least now. So we just have to understand what a k j counts, then we have to understand what n n j counts, and what does it mean to take the difference. So we do it purely combinatorially, and then whatever is the interpretation, we'll translate it back to graphs, right? So what you do is the following: break the permutation, sign permutation, into compartments using right to left minima, then draw a bar at the beginning of the permutation, draw a bar at the least number after the last drawn bar, and call these permutation the cycles of the signed permutation. So here is what you do. So you have a signed permutation, you start reading it from the left, you draw a bar, then you have 1 6, there is a drop, right? So one is smaller than all the remaining, then two is smaller than all the remaining, and four. So you break it into these compartments. Sorry, a cycle in signed permutation is odd if it has odd number of negative signs. So here there are three negative signs, so this is an odd cycle. This is one negative sign, so this is again an odd cycle, but this is an even cycle, so it has two odd cycles. Then what we figure out is that the number of signed permutations with j odd cycle is exactly the coefficient of t raised to j in this polynomial, which apparently, I mean, if you look at the OES, there are various interpretations of a and j, which accounts various things, but something like this was not there, which was sort of interesting thing. Anyway, so you prove this by recurrence. This we actually, anyway, so this is sort of a diversion which I don't want to talk about. Then what this NNJ means, right? So NNJ basically slightly complicated, and it was not really obvious what it counts. We have to do a lot of trial and error to figure out what this is. So we say that a signed permutation of size N is normal signed permutation if if the ith number has positive sign, means that the ith number is actually bigger than the I minus first number. So you call it a normal signed permutation. And we figure out that NNJ is the number of normal signed permutations of size N with J odd cycles. Okay. So the proof of this is a bit sort of non-standard, because it's not an obvious thing to know, but maybe I'll skip the proof of this for now. So this is what it basically does. Yeah, anyway, so let me just skip this for a moment, and so some strange thing that NNJ counts, and then we have to figure out what this difference means. So that is not so complicated, right? So we have this threshold pair in standard form that I defined earlier. So the first two signs should be same, and if you have same signs, then the corresponding consecutive numbers with same sign, then those numbers should be arranged in ascending order. So that's a standard form, right? So then these are exactly those threshold permutations in standard form with j odd anchors. Okay. Yeah, so this is what we have to figure out. And again, that's also, yeah, so let me actually show you this, right? So this is the threshold pair to, so it's just a different way of writing this signed permutation. And so again, it's sort of the case by case thing, again a different way of writing the signed permutation. And what we figure out is that in this different way of interpreting, or whatever, writing this permutation, the first number is less than the second, And yeah, there's again some convention which we find convenient. And yeah, exactly. So this difference is the number of threshold permutations of size n with j order cycles, right? Yeah, and again, the proof is by actual counting. And yeah, so basically actual counting that involves some recurrence elevation. And then we have to translate it to threshold graphs. And I'll actually show you implemented this, right? So our construction of the threshold graph is 1 plus 3 minus 5 minus 2 plus 4 plus and 6 minus. So here 1 and 6 are the odd anchors. So 1 is anchor, again, it's dominant, so it's an odd anchor. Then 3, 5 is not odd anchors, but 2 is anchor. 2 is an anchor because it's smaller than the numbers that come after it, which are 4 and 6. And then it is not an odd anchor because it has the same sign as the previous anchor. 4 is an anchor, but again, it has the same sign, so it's not odd. 6 is an anchor because it is the last number, and it is an odd anchor because its sign is negative. So it has exactly 2 odd anchors. That's what you see here. I mean, this coloring is just for the sake of representation. It doesn't really mean anything in terms of the graph. But so 1, 2, 4, 6, these are the anchors out of which 1 and 6 are odd. And if you translate this construction into an equivalent construction, then you can interpret this as odd cycles with the number of odd cycles, because here you have a odd number of negative signs, right? This was the breakup of this signed permutation into blocks. These are not blocks because they have different signs, but these are compartments using, because of one, right? So there is a block, a line after one, because everything after one is bigger than one. So everything after two is bigger than two. So there is a block here. And then we look at the signs here, right? Here, 3, 4, 5, whatever. So again, one is an anchor, but it comes with a negative sign. So it's not an odd anchor. Two is an anchor, and it's an odd anchor because it comes with a negative sign, opposite sign. 7 is an anchor because it's the last label, and it has been given sign minus, which is opposite of the sign of the earlier anchor. So this is also an odd anchor, right? So this is an example of a threshold graph, which has exactly 2 odd anchors. Again, here also, we have 2 odd anchors, 7 vertices, 6 vertices, right? And then you count these, and the number of these is exactly the distribution given by this sort of strange looking expression. Where is it? Oops, yeah, oh, sorry, it's way back. Yeah, here, whatever this NNJ was, right? So the strange looking expression, it is exactly that. Yeah, this expression, this is the count of these things. It's not so intuitive, sort of a non-intuitive argument, but by sort of some consistent efforts, we're able to count this, right? Yeah, so that's sort of I just wanted to give you a flavor of kind of problems people solve. Again, there are lots of other arrangements for which count. So for example, the yesterday I described the work of Oliver Bernardi, where these trees were counted, right? So then you could ask the same question, that you have some M Catalan arrangement, right? And then the regions of those are equinumerous with Emery trees, labeled Emery trees. Then you will have the characteristic polynomial, right? So then can you interpret the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial? Like, what does a coefficient count? What is the property like of those, you know, how do you interpret these coefficients as labeled MRE trees with a certain property, right? So that is still not solved. But yeah, that's sort of an interesting thing. It comes up in various things in algebraic combinatorics. Okay. Yeah, so with this, I would like to stop. And yeah, if there are questions or some related discussion, I'm happy to talk. To stop. Thank you.
Can you suggest some references where we can basic text, maybe where you can find some material?
Right.
This hyper the arrangements.
Yeah. So the arrangements. Yeah. So this sort of enumerative aspect. So Stanley has this online course on MIT website. So these notes that I refer to, right? So initially I had it somewhere. That is definitely there. But for at least for the sort of real aspect, there is no book as such. I mean, before that, there is this book by Branko Grunbaum from 70s, but it lists a lot of old problems. And interestingly, some of those are still unsolved. And it's mostly about arrangements of lines. But I think the recent literature on, like a book literature on this, is Stanley's notes. Like if you just, you know, Google Richard Stanley arrangement notes, that's the first thing that pops up.
Okay.
And that's quite readable, and it starts with basics. It has all the proofs. There are lots of exercises. Yeah, that's what I would suggest. Yes. And for sort of these other aspects of arrangements and the algebraic topology, algebraic geometry associated with that, then there are some other books. There's one book by Orlik and Terra. It's called Arrangements of Hyperplanes. It's from 92 or something. Then there's book by Dimka. Also, I think the previous speaker showed this book by DeConcini and Procesi.
Yeah,
this is by DeConcini and Procesi. It also covers a very different aspect of arrangements, where you count these number of integer points in a polytope, right? Lattice points enclosed in a polytope, and sort of counting problems and theory evolving from that. That's also, but it goes in a very different direction. The kind of problems that I've said are mostly studied by Stanley and a lot of his students and their students of that school.
Okay. Yeah, any questions from the participants? So can these things be done in Sage, for example? Are there packages available?
For region counting, there is no, but like you could, for experimenting, you could use various sort of, see, one way of here is you have to, you have to figure out a pattern, and that sort of happens by trial and error. And at that level, you could definitely use Sage. But again, there is no specific like hyperplane arrangement package. It sort of depends on, it's like very context dependent. It depends on the equations of the hyperplane. Yeah. But yeah. So for example, these sort of strange expressions. Okay. So we could try to figure out what comes out, what are these numbers, and then go look for these numbers in OEIS and see if there's something somewhere else did they show up. But strangely for us, these numbers were nobody ever dealt them before, so actually we're the first people to contribute to OEIS in this like that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any questions from the participants?
I have a sort of general
Yes.
So everything is over real numbers. Therefore, you have greater than zero xi minus last talk. Not so much this.
Yes. Yes.
Xi minus xj greater than zero, etc. So in complex, when you use also mentioned in the passing something about complex.
Yes.
Okay. And then the complement is not disjoint unions or whatever that.
Yes.
Is.
Yes.
So what corresponds, for example, when the field is different, in particular for C. Or yes. Something else, then what are you counting in some sense? Okay.
Yeah. So if it is over finite fields, we are counting points.
Mm-hmm.
It's a point count. And
what corresponds to greater than zero and less than zero?
Oh, then there is no separation as such, right? So we have a topological separation, right? Because when I remove a hyperplane, I cannot, the thing is disconnected. So in case of finite fields, you basically have some points that satisfy this equation and some points that do not satisfy this equation. So then we count the points which do not satisfy this equation. So there is no real like connected component kind of thing. It's just point count. So number of points that do not satisfy any of this equation. And in the
so complex what corresponds to regions? I mean, you had these, you know.
No, so for example, in finite case, there are no regions as such. And in the complex case, again, there is only one connected component. So there are no regions because it's just single connected component. But then you can have, say, what are the Betti numbers of this? Or, other topological invariants of that thing. So when you remove, these are real co-dimensional too. So whatever is left is connected. So one would like to understand the topological invariants in terms of the intersections of these hyperplanes.
Okay.
That's one aspect. Or again, there is some geometry because it's an affine variety. The complement of union of hyperplanes is an affine variety. So then again, it's a complex affine variety. So it comes with some algebraic geometry data. So you'd like to understand that in terms of the combinatorics of the intersections.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, if there are no further questions, let us thank the speaker for the two wonderful talks, particularly this topic of hyperplane arrangements. I think the questions are, very elementary to phrase, some of these are very difficult to answer. And so thank you very much for these interesting talks, and thank you for accepting our invitation.
So it's my pleasure.
So on behalf of all the participants and the UGC HRDC Center Pune and the Department of Mathematics, I thank you. Thank you very much. So hopefully we will meet sometime.
Sure, definitely.
Offline.
Yes.
Offline,
yeah.
I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, sir.